It's exactly what we need to happen in this nation. And the Bible tells us that this kind of revival that we need, it's not going to start at the White House. Did you hear me? It's not going to come from the White House. I don't think it's going to come necessarily from the schoolhouse. It's going to come from God's house. That's where it starts. If my people, that's you and me, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I'll hear from heaven. You see, if comes before then. If we do our part, then God can do his. Then I'll hear from heaven. I'll forgive your sin. I'll heal your land. So I pray, Lord, let it start right here. Would you do that right now? Just point to your heart and say, Lord, just let that revival start right here in me. Right here in me, Lord. In Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. And again, I know I've already said something, but would you let this worship team know how much we appreciate them? Man, they were, like I said, they were here Wednesday night. They were here Friday night. They were here Saturday morning. They're here two services today. They'll be here till the final amen. I love this group of people. They are so committed to God, and using their gifts, talents, and abilities to bless us. I want you to take your Bibles this morning and let's go to Acts chapter 4. I get excited anytime I hear that somebody's going to preach from the book of Acts. Amen. People call it the Acts of the Apostles, but it's not the Acts of the Apostles. It's the Acts of the Holy Spirit through the Apostles. It's what the book of Acts is. And while you're turning there to Acts 4, there's just a couple of things that I want to make sure that you have on your calendar. First of all, men, I hope that you have it on your calendar. September 9th is our Sharper Saturday. This is going to be an incredible day together for us to sharpen ourselves as men of God, sharpen ourselves as husbands and fathers and as business leaders. So we'll be having more information about that coming up soon. But I want you to at least put it on your calendar, September the 9th. And then September the 10th, is there anybody in the house here today that knows who Bishop Dwight Allen is? I kind of figured that. Bishop Allen is going to be with us on September the 10th. He's going to be preaching in both our 8:30 and our 10:30 services. And he told me to tell you that if he doesn't show up, he's coming to your house and he's going to take off his leg and whip you with it. Oh, we love this man of God. He is the father of this house. He pastored here for more than 30 years. For those of you who don't know him, and you got to look far and wide to find better people than Dwight and Bonnie Allen. Amen. And we're just so excited about them being with us on September the 10th. So make sure you've got that on your calendar as well. Well, last week we began our 21 days of prayer and fasting. And as a part of our 21 days of prayer and fasting, we began a series of sermons that we're just calling Powerful Prayers from the Bible. We're looking at prayers that were prayed by people like you and me, ordinary people like you and me, but prayers that were powerful enough that they got the attention of God and they got the response of God. You remember last week we talked about the prayer of Jabez, and isn't that a powerful prayer that he prayed to the God of Israel? Oh, Lord, bless me indeed. Oh, Lord, enlarge my borders. May your hand continue to be with me. And Lord, may I not give in to the temptations and the attacks of the enemy so that I will not cause pain to others. And then the Bible just simply said the Lord granted him his request. Don't you love that when God grants your request? And the reason I believe that God granted his request is because of what the Bible said about him earlier in that passage, is that he was more honorable than all of his brothers. That in spite of how his mother may have treated him and what she named him, he kept honoring her. He kept respecting her. And in spite of how people may have treated him that would have potentially caused pain in his life, he still treated them with honor. He still treated them with respect. And he treated God with honor, and he treated God with respect, and he didn't hold it against God, the pain that he had in his life. He didn't blame God for that pain. He didn't blame people for that pain. And God was able to do amazing things in his life. And the prayer of Jabez was a prayer of blessing, but today I want us to look at the prayer of the early church. And the early church prayed many prayers. But especially this prayer that we're going to look at in a few moments in Acts chapter 4 that begins down around verse 23. But it's going to take me a few minutes to get down to verse 23 because I've kind of got to give you some background information as to why they were praying the prayer that they prayed in verses 23 and following. But whereas the prayer of Jabez was a prayer of blessing, the prayer of the early church was a prayer for boldness, was a prayer for boldness. And when we come to Acts chapter 4, verse 2, we discover that Peter and John, disciples of Jesus, we find out that they're in jail. They're in prison. So the question becomes, why? Why have Peter and John, followers of Jesus, why have they been placed into prison? Well, we have to go back a couple of chapters. It begins in Acts chapter 2. You remember in Acts chapter 1, when Jesus was leaving this earth and he looked at his disciples in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, and he said to them, "But you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and then you will be my witnesses." And so in Acts chapter 2, verse 4, we find them receiving the power of the Holy Spirit that Jesus spoke about. And from the moment that they received the power of the Holy Spirit, man, there was a holy boldness that came over every one of them. As a matter of fact, Peter, who couldn't even stand up to a little teenage girl a few days earlier or a few weeks earlier when he denied Christ three times, this same man named Peter who could not even stand up to that little girl ends up declaring in front of thousands of people the gospel of Jesus Christ because now he has a boldness that he has never had before. And that boldness carries over into Acts chapter 3. And when you get to Acts chapter 3, verse 1, you find that Peter and John are on their way to the temple at the hour of prayer. And as they're going into the temple, they notice a man begging for alms. And this man had been crippled all of his life. He had never been able to walk a day in his life. He's probably somewhere around 40 years old at this particular time. And when Peter and John walk by him, of course, he's probably holding out his cup, you know, asking them to drop some silver or gold into his cup. But Peter and John look at him and they say to him, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have." In other words, I don't have silver and gold, but something I do have. They said, "But such as I have, I give unto thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." How many of you know that took some boldness? I mean, this is a guy that's been crippled all of his life. And they had enough boldness to believe God for big things. And when they prayed for that crippled man, they prayed expecting that crippled man to be healed. And healed he was. Man, he got up and he walked. He didn't just walk, but the Bible said that he ran and jumped and danced through the house of God, telling everybody what Jesus had done in his life. And so after that miracle, of course, that miracle got the attention of the people there in Jerusalem. And many of them begin to come to Peter and John and say, "How did you do this? How did you perform such a powerful miracle?" And this was their response. Peter saw this opportunity and he addressed the crowd. And he said, "People of Israel, what's so surprising about this?" Let me just tell you something right now. As children of God, miracles should not surprise us. Somebody just say amen right there. I'm amazed that people are still surprised when God does a miracle. Why are we surprised? Because God is. He's a God of miracles. We're going to talk about more of that in just a minute. And then he says this, and he said, not only that, but why stare at us as though we're the ones who made this man walk by our own power or by our own godliness? And so he gives them the correct answer. He said, for it is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of all of our ancestors, who has brought glory to his servant Jesus by doing this. In other words, this miracle happened in order that glory would come to Jesus. Because as we're going to see here in a moment, of course, it was him that did the miracle. He that did the miracle. And then it goes on and says, this is the same Jesus. Look at their boldness now. This is so important. This is the same Jesus whom you handed over. And you rejected before Pilate, despite Pilate's decision to release him. And then he goes on and says, you rejected the holy, righteous one and instead demanded the release of a murderer, a guy by the name of Barabbas. And then said, you killed, this is bold, folks, you killed the author of life. But God raised him from the dead. I love it. And they said, we are witnesses because we saw him alive after his resurrection. They said that we are witnesses of this fact. So if you want to know why, when we get to Acts 4 and 2, if you want to know why they're in prison, they're not necessarily in prison because they've taken part in healing a man that's been crippled all of his life. They're not even in prison really for talking about what Jesus did. But what puts them in prison is when they start talking about the fact that Jesus is not still dead, but Jesus is alive. Let me tell you something. The establishment of our world and our culture, you know, they're okay with you talking about Jesus past tense. And I'm sure the religious establishment of this day was okay talking about Jesus, a good man, a good prophet, a good teacher, you know, talking about him in those terms. But you see, they killed him, and the last thing they wanted was him coming back to life. And but so here they are, they're preaching the resurrection of Jesus. And not only the resurrection of Jesus, they're also preaching that because he lives and because he rose from the dead, that you and I who die in Christ, that one day we too will rise again. Now notice when we get to Acts 4 and 2, it says these leaders, the chief priests, the captain of the temple police, and especially the Sadducees. Because the Sadducees did not believe in the resurrection of the dead. That's why they were sad, you see. It's because they felt like when you died, you were dead forever. That you would never come back to life again. So they didn't believe in the resurrection of the dead. And so now they're upset and they're disturbed that Peter and John were teaching the people that through Jesus, there is a resurrection of the dead. And so verse 3 says that they arrested them. And since it was already evening, notice they got put in jail for preaching Jesus. For preaching about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That Jesus is not dead. That Jesus is alive. That Jesus is the Christ. That Jesus is the anointed one. That Jesus is the one sent from God to save the world of their sins. And the establishment didn't like that message, and they put them in jail until morning. Well, the next morning, they bring Peter and John in. And they too wanted to know, how did you do this miracle? By what power? And by whose authority? It's almost like they're saying, who gave you permission to do this miracle? And so the Bible tells us in verses 8 and 9 that then Peter, I love it, filled with the Holy Spirit. It doesn't take us long to find out the source of our boldness, does it? Amen? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, look at this boldness, church. Rulers and elders of our people, are we being questioned today because we've done a good deed for a crippled man? Do you really want to know how he was healed? Do you really want to hear this? And then we go on to verse 10, and he said, let me clearly state to every one of you and to all the people of Israel that he was healed by the powerful name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene. Oh, but their boldness is not done. They know that these men are not just men who can threaten to whip them and put them in prison and kill them. They know that they can actually fulfill those threats. But even knowing that, they looked at him and said, you remember Jesus, don't you? He's the man that you crucified. But God raised him from the dead. The very ones who didn't want them preaching that, they're preaching it to those very ones. Now, folks, that is boldness. And then the Bible says in verse 13 that the members of the council were amazed when they saw, even they're amazed, at the boldness of Peter and John. Now, remember that. It's important when we get to the prayer that they prayed. But the council was amazed when they saw the boldness of Peter and John. For they could see that they were ordinary men. Other translations say uneducated men with no special training in the scriptures. But notice, it also says that they also recognized Peter and John as men who had been with Jesus. And I don't believe they're just talking about, hey, we saw these men walking alongside Jesus. No, I believe that the reason why they could see that these men were bold, that even though they may have been uneducated and ordinary men, they were still bold men. Why? Because they had been with Jesus. Let me ask you something. Are people able to look at your life and tell that person's been with Jesus? Man, that person has been with Jesus in prayer. That person has been with Jesus in the Word of God. And so they recognized that boldness, and they recognized them as men who had been with Jesus. And they threatened them. And they said, you got to stop this. You got to stop preaching about Jesus. You got to stop talking about the resurrection of the dead. And they threatened them again and said, listen, we're going to whip you. We're going to flog you. We're going to put you in jail. We could potentially kill you if you don't stop this. But Peter and John replied, man, the boldness. Do you think God wants us to obey you rather than him? We cannot stop talking about everything and telling about everything that we have seen and that we have heard. Well, after they took that stand, these guys looked at him again and further threatened them, but then they released them. And after they released them, this is what happens. As soon as they were freed, Peter and John returned to the other believers and told them what the leading priest and the elders had said. So they go back to the people and they say to them, they've threatened us. They've told us that if we don't stop preaching and teaching and talking about Jesus and Jesus being resurrected from the dead, that they're going to beat us, they're going to flog us, they're going to put us in prison, they're going to kill us. So they tell the other people everything that these elders and priests had said. And I think that's important to know because of how they respond to this news. And notice what it says. It says, when they heard the report, and I'm just going to summarize it here first. But it says, when they heard the report, they prayed. I want to say that again. That when they heard the report, they prayed. They didn't gripe. They didn't complain. They didn't say, God, give us a safe place to hide. They didn't say, God, kill our enemies. They didn't say, God, stop the persecution. Because you see, up until this time, They had not really faced, as the early church, opposition and pushback, but now for the first time, they're facing some opposition. They're facing some pushback, and they're not surprised by it because Jesus told them that this was going to happen. But they don't ask God to remove all of that. But notice what it says they did pray. It says that all the believers lifted their voices together in prayer to God. Now, before we see what they prayed, it tells us how they prayed. Because look at this. It says it was all, everybody say all. All the believers. It wasn't just Peter and John, and everybody else was just kind of observing as Peter and John prayed. No, all of the believers were praying. And it says that all the believers did what? They lifted their voices. That means not only did they pray, they prayed loud. For some reason or another, they prayed loud. Maybe it was because they were a bold people and they didn't care that they had been threatened if they didn't shut up, but they prayed loud prayers. Now, I'm not saying that you have to pray loud prayers for your prayers to be powerful, but there's nothing wrong with people who pray loud prayers. The Bible says all the believers did what? They lifted their voices, and this is so important, together. This is the importance of corporate prayer. This is the importance of unified prayer. Now, there are times when we will come together in a prayer meeting, and people are free to walk around and pray for whatever it is that God puts in your heart to pray. But I'm telling you, there is power in corporate prayer. There is power in unified prayer, where we all come together and we're not all praying different things, but we're all praying for the same thing. And that's what's going on here. They come together and they're all praying for the same thing. They're all praying and believing for God to do the same thing. And notice it says that they lifted their voices together in prayer to God. That's exactly what Jabez did. He prayed to the God of Israel. That's exactly what David did. He prayed to the God of Israel. That's exactly what Jesus taught his disciples to do. Pray, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Why? Because he's the only one that has the power to grant the request that we are asking of. So we pray to God. So we see how they prayed. All the believers lifted their voice together in prayer to God. And listen to what they prayed. Such a powerful prayer. First of all, they lay a foundation before they make their requests. They remind themselves of who God is. And they remind themselves of what his word has already declared. Because listen to what they said. They said, oh, sovereign Lord. That word sovereign means one who has supreme power and authority. One who has all power and all authority. Most of the time that the word Lord or the name Lord is used in the Bible, it comes from the Hebrew word kyrios, but not here. Here it's very strange because the word for Lord is actually the word that we get our word despot from. And it's somebody who has great power and great authority, but chooses to use that power and authority for cruel purposes. A tyrant. But that's not so with God. God has all power and God has all authority, but he uses his power and authority to fulfill his plan, to do good. And notice they said, oh, sovereign Lord, you are the creator of heaven and earth, the sea, and everything in them. Now hear what he's saying there. God, you're the one who created heaven. God, you're the one who created earth. God, you're the one who created the sea. God, you're the one who created everything in heaven. And God, you're the one who created everything on earth. Everything in them, and you are a sovereign Lord. That means you created everything it is, and you have power over everything that is. You have authority over everything it is. You are Lord over everything that is. They're declaring that, reminding them what a mighty, powerful God they serve. How many of you know we serve a mighty God? A mighty God. You say, well, Pastor, I don't have one thing to offer God. I have absolutely nothing to offer God. Well, you just remember, He's a creator. He created everything that is, what? Out of nothing. See, God's not like us. God doesn't need anything to work with. He can just speak it into existence. That's how powerful, that's how sovereign our God is. And then we go on to verse 25, and they continued to pray. And they said, you spoke long ago. Now they remind themselves of something that the Word of God says. You spoke long ago by the Holy Spirit through our ancestor David, your servant. So here they quote Psalm chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, which was a prophetic psalm written by David about the coming Messiah, about Jesus and how he would be treated when he came here to this earth. And they said that you spoke long ago by the Holy Spirit through your ancestor David, your servant, saying, why were the nations so angry? I'll tell you why they were so angry. It's because one has now come on the scene who has all power and all authority, and they feel threatened by the power and the authority that he has. And then notice this, and this was spoken by David prophetically hundreds of years before it happened. He said, why did they waste their time with futile plans? You know what he's talking about here? He's talking about how all of these rulers and nations would come together and crucify Jesus. But how futile that was for them to spend all that time and all that energy crucifying Jesus, only for him to get up and live, only for him to get up out of the grave. Boy, don't you know, if you spend all that time trying to kill him and you think you've succeeded, and then 3 days later you got to deal with him again. How futile. And then they keep praying in verse 25 and said that the kings of the earth prepared for battle. The rulers gathered together against the Lord and against his Messiah. And this was prophesied, that nations would come together, that peoples would come together, that rulers would come together for the sole purpose of coming against Jesus and coming against those who claim to be followers of Jesus Christ. And then Peter and John in their prayers say this. They said, in fact, this has happened right here in this very city. Folks, can I tell you that right here in this very nation, we are seeing peoples come together. We are seeing groups of people come together. We are seeing people in authority come together. What? Against Jesus Christ. Against the Jesus revolution. Against the Jesus movement and against the followers of Christ. And Peter and John said, it's happened right here in this city in Jerusalem. He said, for Herod Antipas, Pontius Pilate, the governor, the Gentiles, the people of Israel. Look at this. They were all united against Jesus. And let me tell you, if they're united against Jesus, they're united against those of us who are followers of Jesus. But he said they all came together, working together against Jesus, your holy servant, whom you anointed. But then I love the next verse. But everything they did was determined beforehand according to your will. God, they didn't realize it. They thought that they had power they didn't have. All they were doing, God, was just being used as pawns in your hand to fulfill your will that you predetermined. Because before the foundation of the earth, he had predetermined that the Lamb of God was going to die for the sins of the world. Going to the cross for Jesus was not an accident, folks. It was divine providence. It was the plan of Almighty God. And all these wicked people did was just be used by God to fulfill his plan. So God's plan, listen to me, God's plan has never been in jeopardy. God's purpose has never been in jeopardy. You reminded, he is a sovereign God. Hallelujah. He's sovereign over all things. And they said, but everything they did, it was already determined, God. according to your will. And then here's the prayer that they prayed, the request that they made. And now, O Lord, hear their threats. God, they're threatening to flog us. God, they're threatening to beat us. God, they're threatening to put us in jail. God, they're even threatening to kill us. And God, hear their threats. But notice they don't say, again, they don't say, God, give us a safe hiding place. They don't say, God, remove our enemies. They don't say anything about, God, stop the persecution. But what they pray is, and give us your servants great boldness in preaching your word. That God, in the face of all of these threats, the threats to flog us, the threats to beat us, the threats to put us in prison, the threats to kill us, God, may we not be overcome with fear because of their threats, but God, give us great boldness so that we will continue to preach your word in the midst of it all. Hallelujah. And that's what you and I'm asking you to join me through these 21 days of prayer and fasting. I'm asking you to join me and let's pray for boldness. You see, the disciples, even though they already had boldness, even the rulers were amazed at their boldness. They said, we know that tough times are not over. We know it's going to get worse. We know it's going to get harder to preach about Jesus and take a stand for Jesus. And so, God, we need you to continue to give us boldness. And not just boldness, but God, we need you to give us great boldness. And I know that we've got young men and women that's about to get ready to go back to school. And we're going to be praying over you next Sunday. You need to be here because we're going to pray a special prayer over you. And I'm praying for you that this school year of 2023 and 24, that God will give you boldness, that you will not be ashamed to identify as a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that you're not ashamed to declare who he is and what he can do to transform your life. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give him praise today. Hallelujah. They prayed for boldness, but it didn't stop there. They prayed for something else. And look at what they prayed for. They said, oh God, stretch out your hand. And the hand of God is significant because it speaks of the power of God. And they said, oh God, stretch out your hand with healing power. May miraculous signs and wonders be done through the name of your holy servant, Jesus Christ. In other words, they didn't just pray bold prayers, they prayed big prayers. They're praying, God, heal the sick. God, raise the dead. God, set those people free who are possessed by the devil. God, do the impossible. God, heal. God, do miraculous signs. God, do wonders. That validates the word that we preach. That validates the name that we preach, God. Do miracles so that there's no doubt in anybody's mind that you are who you say you are and you can do everything that you said you could do. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, forgive me for screaming this morning, but I'm passionate about this. Hallelujah. I'm passionate. So I'm asking you to join me that we not just pray for boldness, church, but that we pray for miracles. How many of you know that we serve a God of miracles? How many of you know that we serve a God who can do the impossible? Hallelujah. Let me tell you where I am in my faith. If we're not careful, we've been praying the same stuff for 45 years. Thank you, Lord. God, give us your traveling mercies. Oh, God, may your presence be with us. Do we remember that he said, I'm never going to leave you, and I'm never going to forsake you, but I'll be with you always, even to the end of the age? Do we remember when we say, come Holy Spirit, that 2,000 years ago he came and didn't leave? He's still here. I think God is up there in heaven right now saying, hey, ask me for something big. Ask me for something big. You see, because what you ask God for says a lot about what you believe about God. If you're only asking God for small things, then you're God small. But if you're asking God for big things, then you're God's big. And I believe God's up there saying, ask me to do something hard so that when I do it, there will be no doubt in anybody's mind that it was me that did it and that it could not have happened without me. And I tell you where I am in my faith. I'm at the place in my faith where I'm not afraid to ask God for anything. Do you hear me? I'm at a place in my faith where I'm not afraid to ask God to heal cancer. I'm not afraid to ask God to heal diabetes. I'm not afraid to ask God to heal heart disease. I'm not afraid to ask God to raise the dead. I'm not afraid to ask God to set free those who are bound by the enemy. That's just where I am in my faith. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Listen. I'm also to the place in my faith because I hear people say, well, Pastor, what if I ask God for something big and he doesn't do it? I don't want to embarrass God. And really what you're saying is, I don't want to embarrass myself. Let me tell you another place I'm at in my faith. Yes, I'm at the point in my faith where I'm not afraid to ask God for anything. But I'm also at a point in my faith where I can handle God saying no. Yeah. And I'm also at a place in my faith where I can handle God saying, not yet. You see, some of you need to know you've asked God for some things that hasn't happened yet. And God says the reason it hasn't happened yet is because it'll happen in my time and it'll happen in my way. And it'll happen in such a way that you don't get glory for it. But I get all the glory and I get all the praise. Oh, I want you to stand all over this room right now. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Golda and Michael, do you believe God does miracles? Let me tell you why Michael and Golda believe in miracles, because they've seen God do a miracle. I don't see Preston right now. I don't know if he's in here. Where are you, Preston? Come on. Come up here just a minute, Preston. Come up here, son. Woo! Hallelujah. Somebody give God praise. Preston, let me tell you something. This is one of the reasons I believe in miracles, because this is a miracle right here. He's not supposed to be here, and he wouldn't be here if it hadn't been that God stretched his hand of healing and touched him. Hallelujah. Preston, every time he had a brain aneurysm that very few people survive. But let me tell you why he survived. Because he had a mom and daddy that stayed on their knees in prayer, and they believed in a God of miracles, that a God that could do some big things. Hallelujah. Preston, every time I see you walk in this building, every time you come by me, every time you come by and see me every Sunday and hug my neck and tell me you love me. And every time you do it, I'm reminded we serve a God of miracles. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Preston. You've come too late to tell me that we serve a God who does not do miracles. I want every one of my prayer partners to get up here to the front of this building. All of my prayer partners. I'm believing God for some miracles this morning. Is there anybody that will believe with me today for some miracles in the house? If you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, the greatest miracle is that God can save you today, and that He has saved you by His Son, Jesus Christ. Maybe you're here today and you need a healing in your body. And I know there's some people here today, you need a healing in your body. What are you waiting on? You need to get out of your seat right now. Take a walk of faith and come down here and believe God to give you your miracle of healing. You may need a financial breakthrough in your house today. Oh, come on, take a walk of faith. Take a walk of faith toward this altar this morning and believe God to do what only God can do. Do you need restoration and reconciliation in your marriage? Do you need deliverance from addiction in your life today? We serve a God of miracles, church. We serve a God of miracles. Come on, as we worship the Lord, as we worship the Lord, we're going to pray and we're going to believe for miracles. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, church. We're not here to just observe. We're not here to just watch. Even if you don't come forward, right where you are, God can do a miracle. But whatever you do, keep your hands extended in this direction, praying and believing God to do the miraculous. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.